te po, ko te po, ko te kōwhao kāputu ki waho, ko te pū, te weo, te more, te rito, ko te aka. Nā te aka te kūkune, nā te kūkune te pūpuke, nā te pūpuke te hihiri. Night or darkness, and te kōwhao, which is literally a hole, united and gave birth to the gods of nature. And we're living in it. We're living in the realm of creation. Yeah, when I look at this rock, I touch this rock, I feel an energy force coming from within it. Then I wonder, this rock was here, and this rock has witnessed generations and generations of human existence. And that takes me back further and further, further, further back to the time of creation. And for me, this rock holds a lot of mana. From a Māori perspective, even the most insignificant looking plant in this forest carries its own mana. And that can apply to human beings as well.
Mana is a difficult word to translate into someone else's culture. Mana is authority and prestige. When people come in contact with things that have some kind of meaning, that object gives them a sense of awe. It's like that particular object produces something that makes you feel that there's some power there.
Any object or any person with true mana can become a gateway into a whole realm of knowledge, both of the material world and of the spiritual world. Every culture on earth carries its own mana.
Sana daya, 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 sana Thank you. 雨が本降りになってんけ。川だ。酒があらへん。すいません。おじいさん。入った。 お前頼んだ言うんだよねお前。
いや頼んだはずなんだ。あ、聞いたの。
お前頼んだわ。
いや頼んだよ。頼ん
だよ。頼んだよ。頼んだよ。必死になって喋ってるのに。
酒。やっぱ肌には酒がない。肌は見えないけども酒は。
Le mouton a mangé les feuilles. S'il n'avait pas mangé les feuilles, c'est que la cérémonie n'aura pas lieu.
Donc alors les dieux ont accepté la prière. Donc les cérémonies vont se poursuivre.
Thank you. Welcome to the extension of the shroud. Could you kindly switch off your mobile phone and do not use the flash on your camera? Thank you. We hope you enjoy this spiritual journey.
Ich kann mich noch erinnern, in meinem Schulbuch wurde dieses Bild als das Bild Rembrandts gezeigt. Die Busse mit den Berlin-Touristen hielten vor dem Museum und die Touristen strömten sofort zu dem Mann mit dem Goldhelm und gingen dann ziemlich schnell wieder raus. Es war das Lieblingsbild der Berliner, unser Mann mit dem Goldhelm.
Als der Mann mit dem Goldhelm sozusagen, weil es ein besonderes Stück war, als ein berühmtes Bild galt, separiert ausgestellt war, also völlig isoliert vom Rest der Sammlung, Hinterfangen mitsamt. Das ist schon sehr theatralisch hier aufgebaut, das Bild auf einem Sockel, wie eine Altarmensa, präsentiert. Es ist eine Sakralisierung des Bildes gewesen. Aber das ist natürlich also völlig unkritisch, aber im Grunde genommen ist das dann eine Art Wallfahrtsort gewesen. Und das Publikum hat das dort bewundert, war tief beeindruckt. Es hat so viele Besucher angezogen, da standen die Menschen in Dreierreihen vor den Bildern und die hintere Reihe hat das Bild eigentlich gar nicht richtig sehen können. Ja, das ist einer männlichen Mona Lisa. Es gab es als Strickvorlage. Es ist in der Werbebranche. Der Mann mit dem Goldhelm war auf Brandyflaschen, als Ram Brandy, nicht? Also als Zeichen für Qualität. Es ist immer die Sehnsucht bei solchen Stücken, auch beim Mann mit dem Goldhelm, Kontakt haben zu wollen mit dem, der es produziert hat, mit dem, der dahinter steht. Und das ist für das Publikum offensichtlich nach wie vor von besonderer Wichtigkeit. Es ist Rembrandt selbst, mit dem ich da gegenüberstehe.
Das ist die letzte Autoradiografie von dem Mann mit dem Goldhelm. Wir sehen hier Schwärzungen, die durch Phosphor in Beinschwarz verursacht wurden. Diese Autoradiografie auch belegen, dass der Pinsel sehr langsam geführt wurde und dass der Pinselstrich sehr schmal ist. Im Gegensatz zu Rembrandt, der immer einen sehr breiten Pinsel verwendet hat. Bei Rembrandt haben wir oft einen Pinselstrich, der geht so und dann gleich wieder zurück, weil er noch so einen Schwung hat. Wir sehen hier noch so eine Art Hilfslinie für die Körperwendung. Und das ist etwas, was wir also bei Rembrandt nie finden würden. Durch die Untersuchungen war es eigentlich dann ganz klar, dass das Bild nicht von Rembrandt sein kann. Ursprünglich hatte das Bild immer einen sehr prominenten Platz in der Galerie. Es wurde dann aber schon, als es noch als Rembrandt galt, aber die ersten Zweifel aufkamen, wurde es schon etwas aus dem Mittelpunkt entfernt. Inzwischen hängt es eigentlich in einer Ecke, ja doch noch so, dass man, es hängt halt.
mit Sicherheit ist das Bild nach wie vor dasselbe. Bilder ändern sich nicht, sie bleiben immer dieselben. Aber was sich ändert, ist natürlich die Beurteilung des Publikums.
Mercy then, mercy then, don't stay to layin' out, stay to layin' out, don't do mine shots, life's in Graceland. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Spanish.
That's why you're all
so Romeo.
We love Elvis.
Sí, español, yo tengo el carnet del 66. Yo estuve en la época de la del Julio Pantola, ¿no? Y después me descubrí y ahora me gusta mucho otra vez. Año y medio, sí. Pero vamos, yo en mi socio de Straight on.
Bring up your left hand a little closer to your face. There you go, that's it, right there. Nine. Do that. Go. Nine. Keep doing that.
Nine. How you going? Oh, you all say you love me. Oh, you all say you love me.
I don't
keep talking. Great. Oh, that's right. If I could be you, if you could be me, for just 1 hour, if we could find a way to get inside each other's minds, if you could see you through my eyes, instead of your ego, I believe you'd be surprised to see that you've been blind. Walk a mile in my shoes, yeah, just walk a mile in my shoes. Might not be that easy, but girl, before you abuse, when it sounds out of cues, walk a mile in my shoes. Well, you guys are just looking really fine here. And if I only had the wings, oh, little angel, I'd climb to the top, and then I'd cry. Walk a mile in my shoes, walk a mile in my shoes, walk a mile in my shoes. Yeah, before you abuse, criticize and accuse, walk a mile in my shoes.
Take it easy there, cowboy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Welcome to Memphis, everybody. It's good to be back.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, His truth is marching on. glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah, His truth is marching.
This is the brain of President Woodrow Wilson. It was obtained from a physician who performed the autopsy on his body. This is the hand of Edgar Allan Poe. This is highly regarded as authentic, although it hasn't been documented yet. DNA testing is going to prove it for us. This is extremely valuable. Certainly the opportunity to own the hand that actually wrote The Raven only comes along once in a lifetime. These are the Curies. The French think they have them in their tomb in Paris, but I have them here. The Curies, as you know, discovered radiation. Touch them with a Geiger counter and you can hear them click. Over here is where I keep the fingers. This is the finger of Amelia Earhart. All of these items are for sale. There's a great demand for body parts. Who knows why people collect these things? For some reason, people seem to feel that what they can't fulfill in their own lives, they can replace with pieces from other people's lives. This little fellow is one of my favorites. We're not sure who or what he even is. He was in the tomb of a branch of the royal family and hidden. Obviously, it was something the royal family was terribly ashamed of. It looks like he died almost gleefully or laughing. It'll command a very, very high price, I'm sure. As in any trade in highly valuable and highly rare things, there are a number of unscrupulous dealers. For instance, there are thousands of Adolf Hitler's fingers available on the market. Through studious authentication, chemical and forensic tests, everything here is authenticated and guaranteed. And that's absolutely true.
Congressman Howard Coburn, out of North Carolina. The Capitol across the street, visible from this office, is recognized, I think, worldwide as the seat of freedom or the birthplace of freedom. I've seen people stand in awe in front of that Capitol. Of foreign people over here visiting, and I've seen tears come to their eyes because they equate that United States Capitol dome with freedom. Well, in the boxes are flags that we will fly over the Capitol in honor of constituents. We want the flag to be flown over the Capitol with the following instructions. The constituent has requested a 3x5 nylon as opposed to cotton to be flown on September 13th in honor of Caroline Barrett Lee on her third birthday. So I'm sure that her parents are gonna value this. Let me see if I can get this open. Of course, here's the flag, the nylon flag. And then that'll be flown over the Capitol. And then a certificate will be enclosed when we get it back. And it says on the certificate that this flag was flown over the United States Capitol at the request of Howard Coble, in this case, a member of Congress. That's very important to the constituent who requested it, that he or she can tell her neighbors, by George, this one was flown over the Capitol. Mine flew over the Capitol. Mine flew over that dome that represents freedom worldwide. Seen this done, but I am told that the designated crew probably consists of four or five different people whose job is all day long to hoist flags. Americans have always been very conscious of the significance of our flag. We've always been flag happy in this country.
when you pull out this car, and it's like everybody turns and admires it. All the response you get from everybody, it's a trip. It's something you don't get when you just pull out your regular car and you go to town and you're like invisible.
Sense of pride, because you say, I built this, you know, I built this the way I wanted to, I did all the work. And a lot of the people that come by, they say, you know, that car is beautiful. It's no longer a car, it's a work of art. So a lot of people, they identify with their cars. You know people by what they drive, and we just like the lowriders. That's our identity, that's what we're into.
ಮತ್ತೆ Papa!
Hallo? Yo, Dio. Dad. Dad, I'm going to go to the car. I'm going to go to the car. Huh? Hey, Lang.
Thank you.
there was a young man from Eggington, England, and his father was a Presbyterian minister. And that summer, there was a lot of heat lightning and lightning. And that little boy went to his dad and asked him, what causes all that stuff? What's doing this? And his father said, that comes from Heavenly Father, and that's heat, lightning, and lightning. And the lightning to this young man expressed a tremendous amount of power. And when he got older, he was fascinated with electricity and lightning. And then he thought if he could harness that lightning force and perpetuate himself out of this world on a magnetic lightning force beam, he would have the true answer. So he began to collect different types of machinery that would generate a lot of electricity to perpetuate yourself back into the heavens on a magnetic lightning force beam. And that is a fundamental basis for the Forevertron. The concept is you crank the cranks and make sure all the switches are just exactly right. You walk up the spiral staircase, get inside the glass ball inside the copper egg, and when that was completed, that meant he's ready to power on into the heavens forevermore. Then there is a giant telescope for the non-believers or doubting Thomases to see if he really made it there or not. I wouldn't pay two hoots to non-believers because we just overpower them anyway. There it is. And if you want to go over and you want to tap on anything, you'll see it is the real thing. And it's got 100,000 pounds of copper and another 800,000 pounds of metal in it. You're looking at whatever it is, and you could touch and feel it, even though it's made from whatever it is. It's a philosophy, you see. They're not phony. There are over 1,000 ton of things that are associated with the major trip back into the heavens on a magnetic lightning force beam. And everybody would be happy that particular day. The band will be playing. A one, a two, a one, a two, three, four. There would be royalty witnessing this, and there is a gazebo on one end of the machines for Albert and Victoria to sit in to witness this thing happening. Albert loved it. You know, Albert was an inventor type, and he liked creative people. I didn't speak to Queen Victoria myself, but I know Albert loved what was going on here. doctor goes off into the heavens on his magnetic lightning force beam. That will be forevermore. Think so shall it be.
Ha, 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 ha.